Republican Congressman Justin Amash has left the conservative House Freedom Caucus. Amash made the announcement last night. It comes just weeks after the congressman became the first Republican to call for impeachment proceedings against President Trump.
The Freedom Caucus was founded in 2015. Its members were credited with orchestrating then House Speaker John Boehner of Ohio's resignation. A new book examines how this group of conservatives actually maneuvers. Legislative Hardball, the House Freedom Caucus and the Power of Threat Making in Congress draws on the group's tactics and effectiveness. In general, members tend to be allies of the Trump White House. Here to talk about his new book and the Freedom Caucus, we are joined by the author, Matthew Green. He's a professor of politics at Catholic University of America right here in D.C. Welcome, Professor Green.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us. Now, something I have always been fascinated by is how a group which is largely libertarian in nature, whenever it comes down to policy, has so aligned itself with President Trump. How do you see that alliance and how it has developed in the last couple of years?
So one of the things about the Freedom Caucus that not many people realize is that they have a set of ideological principles,
right,
but they've also been very much attuned to voters and what they feel like their constituents want, and also aware of the fact that they're a small group, 35 to 40 members, and so they have to have some allies, folks who can help them out. And in the 2016 election, they saw that a lot of their voters were very supportive of Trump, more actually than they, in some cases, they anticipated, which led them to kind of rethink whether or not they should, be opposed to Trump or resistant of Trump. And then also realizing that because they're a small group, having an ally in the White House like President Trump could be very useful to them.
Yeah, and they've never been more powerful than they are today.
I would argue they certainly are. I think that's right. Because they have folks like a former member, Mick Mulvaney, who is the chief of staff to the president. So they have these connections with the White House that give them outside influence.
So tell us about, you question whether the caucus deserves credit for Boehner's resignation. Why do you say, I mean, that it really has been the conventional wisdom here in Washington. Do you disagree?
I do, to a degree. I think that there's several reasons for that. One of them is that that Speaker Boehner was reportedly already thinking of leaving, so it wasn't as if he was desperate to stay as Speaker of the House. Another and more important factor is that the Freedom Caucus only had about 40 members. In order to remove Boehner, they would need a majority of the House to do so. And Democrats were not interested in working with the Freedom Caucus to remove Boehner, even though they're Democrats. Mm-hmm. So they didn't have the votes. What they could do, though, is force the House to have a vote on whether to keep the Speaker through a motion to vacate the chair. And from Boehner's perspective, that would put a lot of his members in a vulnerable position because they'd have to vote for a Speaker who wasn't very popular with conservatives. So that threat was significant enough for Boehner to reconsider staying as Speaker, but it wasn't as if they could actually get the votes to force him out.
Let's talk about the origins of the Freedom Caucus. So in 2009, immediately after the election of President Obama, we saw the creation of this Tea Party, and then you had the Tea Party wave in 2010. But you say that the Freedom Caucus started in 2015 in terms of it being actually formalized. Is the Freedom Caucus the same thing as the Tea Party or what we knew as the political movement of the Tea Party? And if they're not, explain the distinctions there.
Yeah, so I would say they are not. Now, they do have, I think, some similarity in that they can draw upon a kind of grassroots conservative uprising that did start with the Tea Party movement under Obama. But the Tea Party movement was still very much a grassroots kind of bottom-up organization. Some might disagree with that, but it wasn't driven by Congress itself. So you had a Tea Party caucus, which consisted of members of Congress, but it was not clear how well connected they were with the broader Tea Party movement. With the Freedom Caucus, you had, I would say, it was definitely Congress-driven. It was members in, particular kinds of members in the House of Representatives, who said, we want to form an organization that is conservative, but is focused very much on how we can maximize our influence in the House, as opposed to a kind of grassroots, we need to get more Republicans elected and check President Obama.
It really is about power. You're absolutely right. And this is something I've always been fascinated by, which is the origins of the Tea Party itself. There were a lot of libertarians who looked at it as the libertarian moment. They said, this is the final uprising. What it really was, a rejection of the Democratic establishment. It didn't have the policy underpinnings necessarily that so many libertarians in Washington kind of wished upon the grassroots movement. Is that what you've seen with with the House Freedom Caucus and how they've transformed with the rise of President Trump?
Well, I think that gets to a key point about not just the Tea Party, but the Freedom Caucus, which is that it's often depicted in the media as everyone agreeing on the same issues. It's all conservative or what have you. But even within the Freedom Caucus, you have different groups. You have some that are more libertarian oriented. You have others that are more social conservatives. You have others that have a combination. They may publicly take a position that they agree upon, but before they do so, they're meeting privately and hashing out these differences. And so in some ways, the Freedom Caucus had internally the same kind of tensions you might see in the party at large. And so, yes, there's a libertarian element to it, but there's also a kind of anti-democratic party element or even a social conservative element to it also.
That is really interesting. And I think the key point that we have to focus on is that it's not a uniform ideology that governs the Freedom Caucus.
That's correct.
It is something that moves within power as a way to reject the Democratic establishment. How do you think they're working right now with Kevin McCarthy? There haven't been that many sparks that have been flying, which I find very interesting.
Yes, I find that interesting as well, because when Boehner decided to step down, Kevin McCarthy was the natural successor, but he faced a lot of resistance from the Freedom Caucus. And there have been multiple times when caucus members have criticized McCarthy, and sometimes even still do publicly criticize him. What's going on there is not entirely clear to me of that relationship, but one possibility is that when you are in the minority party, as the Republicans now are, you often are more unified because you all have one shared grievance, which is that you're in the minority.
Right.
You want to get out. And so rather than fighting with each other, you work together. I think also, you know, Kevin McCarthy appears to do a good job of kind of deferring to the caucus on some of the more assertive tactics that they use, blocking legislation or protesting things on the floor. So they're willing to kind of be the front line in kind of pushing the Democrats, and then Kevin McCarthy can kind of step back and act as a more statesmanlike leader. That could be going on there as well.
So 2016, we see the election of President Trump. In 18, you see this progressive wave in of sorts, if you will, particularly in the Democratic side of things in the House. Could you say that the progressives have emulated what we saw from the Freedom Caucus from 2010 and then 15 at formalizing? Do you see that shaping up on the left with the Progressive Caucus, most personified by AOC and some of her ilk, Ro Khanna and such?
Yeah, it's possible. Mm-hmm. It's a little early, I think, to say at this point if that's what's happening. And there's a couple reasons why I'm resistant to say that we're seeing just the equivalent on the left. One is that you know, generally speaking, Democrats are more in favor of proactive legislation and a proactive federal government. So the idea of blocking legislation may not necessarily jibe with them or their constituents. Another reason is that the Progressive Caucus is much bigger. It's got about 100 members. It's much harder to get 100 folks to agree on something.
Right.
And they don't have a binding rule like the Freedom Caucus does. They can't force everyone to vote together. The other thing I think is interesting is that Pelosi, the Speaker of the House, has done a really good job incorporating members from different wings of her party into the decision-making process, so they don't feel left out. Whereas the Freedom Caucus had folks who were completely excluded. They had no say. They weren't on major committees. They weren't part of leadership. So there was a sense that we can't get anything done as is. We need to form an organization in order to get more leverage.
Well, that was the real criticism of Boehner and of Cantor and that regime, is whenever they were really keeping down much of the Freedom Caucus and the Tea Party wave that brought Republicans into power and arguably had the grassroots behind them. So it really was that core tension between the establishment party, which has a very pro-Wall Street tax cuts agenda, with the Freedom Caucus, which may agree on some of those points, but they ultimately wanted to cut spending, they wanted to oppose the Obama administration, and they didn't want to conciliate at all with the former president. Yeah. That really is a core tension. I think your question was really on point, which is about how can the left emulate that? The real question, I think, for the future is, how do you see the Freedom Caucus working within the confines of power now? They have this ally in the White House. I found it very interesting that they've all become the proponents of declassification with FISAgate and with Russia, which is something that not necessarily, which does fit with their more libertarian principles of oversight, but not necessarily something they would have even thought about 10 years ago.
So that's, again, one of the reasons why this view that they're all just, you know, monolithic conservatives who are loyal to the party no matter what is an overstatement. And there are areas of agreement that have emerged from time to time. FISA is one, dealing with felon rights and prison reform.
Criminal justice reform.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And so there are elements and ways in which they can work together, which is where I think it's one of the more interesting dynamics. And one member of the Freedom Caucus even said, Democrats want to work with me because if the Freedom Caucus supports something, President Trump will support it, and it's more likely to be enacted.
The book is called Legislative Hardball, The House Freedom Caucus and the Power of Threat Making in Congress. Catholic University's Professor Matthew Green, thank you for joining us this morning on Rising.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you, my pleasure.
Really appreciate it. Next on Rising, Nevada is the first state with a female majority legislature.
State Senator Ivana Cantela says the power shift has brought discussions to the table that might not otherwise have ever emerged. She tells us more next.